I think that actually recorded the entire 15 minutes. It's a miracle. Okay, so we have Enoch Coffin dancing on one of the tabletop slabs at St. John's Burying Ground in Providence, Rhode Island. I remember those slabs. They're right next to the back of the church as being black with age. But I recently watched a video tour of H.P. Lovecraft's New England that went into the burying ground, and those slabs actually look white, kind of dirty white, but not black with age. So I must be misremembering that. So, alright, so the walkway took us toward the back of the venerable church, to a spot of land where we approached a few tabletop tombs that were entirely black with age. I might have to change that. I think I will. The artist leaped onto one of the slabs and danced irreverently. Alright, no, he doesn't dance like that because he's not a queen, although he is bisexual. "You're a merry fellow, Mr. Coffin," the black woman addressed him. "Would you court a woman in such a place?" He stopped his silly capering and looked around. "I'd bring her here on a moody moonlit night and tell her such a ghastly tale that she would flee in horror. That would be fun." As a side note, that's exactly what H.P. Lovecraft did. He took a woman into this graveyard, and she recorded this in her memoir of Lovecraft. And he told her this story as they were either sitting on these tombs or walking in the graveyard. And he scared the crap out of her to the point where she got up and she ran away from Lovecraft to this she followed the path up to Benefit Street. And she said, "I had to get away from him. I just had to get away from him." It was like he became the monster that she had to flee. And he followed her nonchalantly. And then she said that when he reached her at the street, he had this look of triumph and glee on his face. And I was like, "Wow, that's H.P. Lovecraft's idea of a date. I approve." All right. So, "I fear you are not a romantic soul, Mr. Coffin," the woman scolded. "I'm a beast, my lady," he rejoined, bowing to her, and then leaping off the opposite side of the tomb toward the church. "Pah! What the hell is this?" We walked to where he stood and saw the curious pile of soiled clothing and bits of bones and other less recognizable debris that lay bundled on the earth. "God, it stinks. Someone meant to bury their pet or mother and change their mind." I added "and mother" at the last the last moment, just because I'm a wanker. "You doing okay, mother? Are you eating your spaghetti, mother?" "Mother, blood, blood, mother." "Someone meant to bury their pet or mother and change their mind. Look at that hat. It's been gnawed on by graveyard rats, by the look of it. Ever seen anything so filthy? Pah!" "It certainly reeks," I expressed, as Miss Dubois left my side and knelt before the pile with the strangest smile on her enchanting face. I watched as she picked up the grimy hat and sniffed at it. "You don't want to touch that stuff, my dear. It's coated with heaven knows what." Without answering me, she placed the hat onto the pile and leaned a little closer to the rubble. Subtly, she blew upon the heap, and as she did so, the sunset grew a little darker. I watched her eyes as they caught the reflected, as they caught and reflected the gold and amethyst shades of sundown. Well, this has been an entertaining evening. I think I want to change that to enchanting evening. I have enjoyed your company, the lady informed us, standing and obviously signifying that our exploit was at an end. It was wonderful to meet you, Mr. Sinclair. I hope that we may look forward to a new collection of tales soon. I have curtsied, but that needs to be changed to bowed, because men don't curtsy, do they? Well, unless they're me. I bowed to her and shook her hand. My publisher has been making encouraging noises in that direction. She turned to the artist. Good day, Mr. Coffin. The handsome man refused her outstretched hand, strode to her, and took her into his arms. The pleasure has been all mine, he sang, as he lowered his head and pressed his mouth to her exposed bosom. Let's come here alone some night before you leave, and I'll spin you a macabre tale. I think not, Seta, she returned, as she gently pushed him from her. What curious creatures, I thought, as we followed the red brick path up to Benefit Street. Followed. Now I have followed again. I do this all the time. I repeat words too often. But I followed Miss Dubois up some steps and then stopped as, holding on to the black metal handrail, the woman turned to gaze one last time at the ancient church. I turned as well and saw the impish figure that watched us from where it stood near one of the flat tombs. Was it a child, perhaps, dressed in outlandish garb? As I watched, it raised one arm and seemed to wave to us. But something about its appearance disconcerted me, and I did not return its gesture. The lady standing just before me did, however, lifting her handsome hand and moving it peculiarly. Moving it oddly as twilight engulfed the sky. Oh, now my allergies are all acting up. Alright, that's part one of the unkempt thing, which is... Hey, allergies, darling, allergies. From the forthcoming book, Encounters with Enoch Coffin, to be published next year by Dark Regions Press. This is a book that I am writing, have written. I've finished my tales. And Jeff is working on a long tale set in Boston, where we actually get to see the studio home where Enoch Coffin lives. I love stories about Boston, so I can't wait to read that one. And then he has, his stories are fairly short, 4,000, 5,000 words, whereas mine are up to 6,000, 8,000, 9,000, and 11,000. So he has a ways to catch up before he's written as much for the book as I have. I really enjoyed writing these stories, and this is the first book that I've written while I've moved my laptop and my writing up here to the dining room, so that I could be closer, keep an eye out on my mother, who I really need to keep a close watch on her because she's getting so feeble. And I thought, oh man, am I going to be able to write here? Because it's so distracting having her in that chair right there. And that's where she sits, and so I'm trying to write while she's babbling and asking me questions about where are the dead people. Oh man, I am not looking forward to senility. Some people say I'm already there. Anyway, it's been a wonderful experience writing this book with Jeff, and writing a book up here in my new writing station. That's always just such a relief when I can work in a new working space, and so great. And so after this book is published, Jeff and I have a few other books to write on our own, and then we are going to return to Enoch Coffin and write an Enoch Coffin novel. Jeff has written lots of novels. I've never written a novel, so he is going to teach me how to do that. Alright. Okay, so I shall, hopefully this will all record, and I'll see you all later on. Next time I'll shave. I won't be feeling so tired. I've been feeling really tired today. I always feel really exhausted after I've written a book. So, but eventually I won't be feeling so tired, so I'll be able to have the energy to shave and do some fabulous makeup and be the queen of Eldritch Horror. Shalom.